Hey everyone, I'm Jameson. Back in my mid to late 20s, I got on this big dating kick and I was going on as many first dates as I could. And after one of my first dates, I was inspired to write this open letter and I'm going to read it for you now. An open letter to the man I went on a first date with yesterday afternoon. Dear Brett, the name has not been changed to protect his identity. Sorry, Brett. We talked about four things on our date yesterday. For 1 minute, we talked about acting. For 5 minutes, we talked about you living in a tent in a hospital as a child while doctors determined you were allergic to chocolate, basil, and oregano. For 10 minutes, we talked about your father on dialysis and your mother with stage 4 cancer. And finally, for 90 minutes, we talked about the relationship you recently ended with Carlos, a tailor. During our coffee date in a cafe designed to look like a forest, I slipped away to the restroom often, hoping that when I returned, we would stop talking about Carlos and move on to something else. But I couldn't fool you. As soon as you finished up your phone conversation you had to have while I was away, pretending to urinate, you paused, then jumped right back into Carlos's struggle with commitment and his abandonment issues. I know Carlos had, as you said it, a sweet and innocent face, but you should have known he was never going to be faithful when you caught him multiple times on that sex website, Adam for Adam, looking for, quote, sex without condoms. When our date was finally over and we walked outside and saw the Celebrity Scientology Center, you said, I was just talking to someone about this. Who was it? Well, it was me, Brett. It was me. We talked about it the night before on the phone, not even 24 hours prior, but I didn't want to be selfish and take up more of your time with an explanation. After all, you didn't want to be late to your final dinner date with Carlos. I agree that it was important for you guys to see each other again, so he could finally hand over that new slipcover he sewed for your couch. Brett, I never learned what you do for fun. And you certainly learn nothing about me except for possible speculation that I have an overactive bladder. But you were very cute. When I'm your age, I hope that my neck skin is as firm as yours, but my logic is not nearly as pathetic. And I'm sorry, but I lied. I don't think it was a good idea for your 39-year-old ass to be dating a 19-year-old twink. In closing, I hope you got that new couch slipcover from Carlos. At least now, you can sit on your newish couch and relax when you come home from a hard day at... Wait, you never told me what you do for a living. Sincerely, Jameson. Jameson Scala. The guy with the red hair. Remember? We went on a date right before you met Carlos for the last time? Oh, never mind. Well, to boot, the story wraps up. Years later, I went to a gay poker night and I ran into Brett and I instantly knew it was him and we had been introduced and he said, gosh, you look so familiar. Do I look familiar to you? Do you have an idea of how we might know each other? He didn't remember me. And I feigned ignorance and I was like, gosh, I don't know. Maybe we worked together, like maybe we went to college and just trying to speculate all the possible ways. And I was just totally pretending like I didn't know who he was just because I thought it was funny. And anyway, we ended up all sitting down to play poker at different tables. And of course I got placed next to him randomly. So we're playing poker and in the middle of the game, he got excited and he hit his wine glass and spilled an entire glass of red wine all over me, which just felt like a very special way to end this story. So Brett, wherever you are today, I hope you're well. Bye everyone.
My aversion to dating stems from one basic fear, having to rebuild myself all over again if, and in my experience, when we break up. So I don't date. But I like to make excuses as a way to justify my fear. Excuse number one, online dating is bullshit. I am both too young not to use and too old to give a shit about online dating. Swiping? Fucking stupid. I've met exactly one person in person after years of bumbling and Tindering and swiping on people's faces. You know, and the one person I did meet was married. We met in West Hollywood at Conservatory, an overpriced gay hole. I think I actually recommended it. The wine is $16 a glass. Nothing should cost $16 a glass. Except for maybe my pride, which I swallowed to tell you this story. So, you know, like an insanely kind person, I said, well, I'll get the first round. But there was only one round. And during it, she tells me she's married. So my first thought is, then what the fuck are we doing here? And apparently this is dating. Not a question. This literally is dating. So, you know, we're like three swallows of wine from the end of our glass. You know, so she continues to keep telling me how her wife encouraged her to get on Bumble so that she could start making new friends in LA. Great. She said, yeah, this is what people do. They make new friends in LA on Bumble. Great. I did not know that. I guess if you're already married, you got all kinds of time to just be making friends. I feel like there are three things I need to know about you if I'm dating you, like as an adult. One, are you married? Two, do you have any kids? Three, what STDs do you have? Baseline questions. Excuse number two, polyamorous, or rather, happily non-monogamous people are everywhere. First off, what the actual fuck? No, literally, like, how many people are you fucking? Two, I guess, you know, to each their own. Get it, own it, date, sleep with, whoever, however, lovely, consenting adult humans. Third, being ethically non-monogamous is a thing. Follow me on this. Because is this some kind of tricky word porn? Are they trying to dupe me into believing that being loved a little by two people is better than being loved all the way by one person? And now that their actions are out in the open, there's no shame attached to them. So the term open relationship actually got upgraded to this new term, ethically non-monogamous. I mean, they are so upfront about the truth that they want to fuck other people that they take pride in it, in that action or actions or getting action. Like, people are just fucking people all over the place in this scenario and everyone's cool with it. The point is, they should really have their own space to meet one another. Meet one another. Because some of us have nowhere to meet anyone. I mean, it baffles me that so many people have met somebody and gone on a first date. And it's turned into courtship and grown into mutual respect and hopefully love and engagement party and marriage. And now they're here staring back at a woman's profile who's been alone for 5 years. And 5 years is a long time as a single woman in your 30s. Especially when you're like peaking sexually and you're just like losing years to a silicone dick. Like, I'm just losing years, my most flexible years. Like, if I just was talking to someone who got out of prison and was like, oh, how long were you in for? And they were like, 5 years. You'd be like, oh, holy shit, that's a long time. Also, why am I talking to someone who just got out of prison? It's a stupid example. The point is that when I see that these happily non-monogamous people are in the space where women are seeking women, I'm not only reminded that I am sadly monogamous, ethically monogamous, but that I am also utterly alone. And I've just taken an extra 5 seconds to swipe left, you lucky sexually active polyamorous fuck. And even though all of that is going on under the surface, the real reason I swipe left is because I just want to fall in love with one person, not two. Talk about being a third wheel. I remember my 20s when we'd go to brunch. Table for nine. I just want to ride a bicycle. Which is actually harder to keep steady. Excuse number three. Piggybacking on excuse number two. I don't know where to meet you one. I'd have to say all the lesbians live on the east side of town. I'd also say, I don't know who's gay over there or just into crystals. I'd say I've asked a lot of my friends to introduce me to anyone they know is single. I'd also say none of them ever have. I'd say that most of you figured this out already, you know, how to be happy with somebody else and somebody else, like our polyamorous friends. And I guess I'd say, yeah, if you know of anyone willing to dive into this cesspool of vulnerability, let me know.
Hey, mama, I buried you a month or two ago.
Isn't it interesting that even when you're trying to do something from a sense of pride, you can have the realization that you are still blocking things and that you are still ashamed of certain parts of your life, of certain parts of the narrative of your life, that you barely can come to terms with yourself, let alone to express it to anybody else. And I don't know if it's because of the generation of trans people that I'm in. I wasn't part of the generations who lived quietly, silently, and dealt with turmoil that I can't even imagine. And I'm not one of the younger generations today that, while they still have a lot to face, are able to reconcile how they feel about their gender, about their sexuality, in a way that people my age, because I'm 33, we just weren't given access to when we were younger. So that's all to say, I almost told a story that was bullshit so that I could avoid telling you what's really bothering me. I was going to tell you a cute story about my last straight boyfriend, Billy, and how his coming to see me as a real guy necessitated our breakup, and how it's so bittersweet in that sort of gender validation to be rejected. But that's not the breakup that's weighing on me right now. My grandmother was the person I was most afraid to come out to. And I think coming out as transgender and gay, you can deal with a lot of reactions. You can take the acceptance. You can offer forgiveness. You can get in a drag-out fight and yell at each other. But denial is devastating. And denial was kind of my grandmother's equilibrium, now that I'm old enough to look back on and see what that was going on. A lot of the stuff that we went through was because people in my life were living in denial of reality. And part of my coming out was me trying to reconcile with reality. To face what is, and not what I wanted it to be. Not what they thought it should be. So my telling my grandmother the truth meant that our relationship had to change. I took a year after my social transition started, living as the person I knew myself to be before I started my medical transition. And once the medical transition started, that was when my family realized that this was real and that there was no going back. And that's when they began to fade out on me. And I expected it from the rest of my extended family because I never expected much from them to begin with. They just didn't want to be there for me, and I could come to accept that. My grandmother was always someone who told me I was special. And always told me that she would always love me no matter what. So when she stopped wanting to talk to me, stopped seeming to care about me, when she and the rest of the family knew that I was about to have major surgery, top surgery for my chest, and not a single one of them called or wrote to me, not even a DM or a text message to say good luck. And I had to recuperate the week before Christmas by myself, essentially. It broke my heart more than any man would ever be able to do. And it made me angrier than I'd ever been. And I was a mess of hormones and painkillers and grief. And I explained to her everything that occurred on my end and how it made me feel. And she lied to me. She made up a terrible, dumb excuse about why she forgot the surgery, and I realized things weren't going to get better in terms of honesty, and I told her that we had to stop talking. And for the most part, over the next couple of years, I kept my word. And the worst incident that caused us to not talk for over a year was on my birthday last year. She called. I hadn't heard from her in months and months. I hadn't heard from anybody. And all of a sudden, I got a call at like 9 p.m. at the end of the day. It only took a couple minutes for the conversation to escalate to the point that she was yelling at me that I needed to learn to accept what things were. That I needed to accept that I would always be her granddaughter. She hung up on me, and that was the last I heard from her. For almost a year. About a week and a half ago, I got a call from my aunt that immediately stopped, and I thought maybe she butt-dialed me. I texted her back, you know, what's going on? Is everything okay? And about an hour later, a string of texts just started flooding in. I guess the signal had been bad at the hospital, so I just got everything that she tried to tell me over the course of the last couple hours at once. She was still apparently conscious enough to recognize language, and if I had anything to say to her, I needed to say it. And it must have been because I didn't have even the time to think. But before I knew what I was doing, I was just singing to her. The same songs that she used to sing to me as a kid when she wanted to comfort me and make me feel less scared. And then I told her that I loved her and that I knew that she loved me. And then my aunt told me that she had to make more calls. And that was it. A couple hours later, I got a text telling me that she had passed. That was the last I heard, really, from my family. I know that not being able to reconcile my anger with my family has caused me to not be able to have intimate relationships with people. And although I wish I could have this revelation under less stressful circumstances, I'm still grateful for it. And I'm grateful to my grandmother for the time that we spent together that was fruitful and for the lessons that I got when we had to be separated. And now I'm gonna be able to just carry the positive memories I have with her and let go of the rest. And I'm just proud of myself that I was able to figure that out. That I was able to figure out I was living in bitterness. And I'll tell ya, living in bitterness, carrying bitterness for somebody else is like drinking poison and hoping that it kills the other guy. And I want to live, so. All right, well, thanks for listening.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to... Oh, there's... my Beastie Boy back there. Welcome to my bedroom. My phone is propped up on a big book. It is a large print book about Winston Churchill. So I have let quarantine turn me into an old man. Thank you so much. Will I read the book? Probably not. Is there a tripod downstairs that could have worked 10 times better? 10 times better. Yes. Okay. But here we are. Sorry if it's wobbly is my answer. Yes, I do have a fire alarm that has been torn out of my wall. I was gonna talk about my other breakup though that I've been thinking about in quarantine because I did break up with my vice of emotional eating a few years ago. And obviously, you know, there's always gonna be a little, it's always gonna be poking its head out once in a while. But I mean, I was definitely someone who, you know,
every feeling was going into every bite that I ate. And I actually started going to see a therapist about it. And I had an eating disorder where I was chewing up food and then spitting it out. And she said, what if I told you that I also do that? And I was like, I don't think that's what you say here. I don't think that's what happens now. If I come in and I'm like, I'm addicted to heroin, you're not like, oh, thank God you brought it up. Right? So that was a bit weird. But therapy really did help me get over my emotional eating. And I've just been thinking about how grateful I am that I've broken up with that vice, because we are in quarantine and it's very hard to avoid your vices, you know, in that way at this time. So I just want to encourage everybody that if you are struggling with anything that you feel like is a little out of control or anything, there's a lot of therapy out there and available, and it really got me through that. But I am very grateful for the fact that that I can feel outside emotions towards things and not just put them onto pieces of cake and eat them. But did I try to like wrap this up with a bow too much? That was stupid. Anyway, thanks for having me on the show. I really appreciate it.
So every year my family and I would go to the beach, and I was a total fish. I would be in the water from the time I got in there till they dragged me off kicking and screaming. And my mom was more than happy to lay on the beach and tan with one eye on a book and one eye on me until she could finally convince me to leave. But she had one rule, and that rule was that I could not go in the water if there were no adults. So when I was about 8, we were down at the beach, and my mom needed to go back and get something from the condo. She was grabbing, I think, like more sunscreen and snacks and going to the bathroom. And for whatever reason, I guess the waves looked particularly inviting, in a rare act of rebellion, I ran into the water. And it was not long until I got pulled into a riptide. And I remember I was swimming and flailing and trying to get out of it and looking around to see if the lifeguard saw or if anybody saw, but it didn't look like they had. And no matter what I did, I could not break free from it. And I eventually started to get more and more tired. And just as I was about to go under, this guy showed up on a boogie board and he grabbed me and he pushed me back to shore. And I was sitting there just exhausted and dazed. And he checked on me real quick and then he went back in the water. And I made it back to the blanket before my mom did. She didn't know anything about it till tonight. So the most significant breakup of my life happened 6 months ago when my partner of 10 years told me that she wasn't sure about our future together and moved out. And it was devastating. I was leveled. And I knew that on top of that, as soon as the shock cleared, there was going to be this tidal wave of emotions and processing coming my way. And I decided that I was going to take it all at once. I was going to experience all of it consciously and intentionally. And as it came, I wouldn't try to stuff it down with work or put on a brave face or escape my feelings or anything along those lines, or like parcel it out. I was like, let it hit as it hits. And this was a decision that I was able to make out of extreme privilege and luxury. For one, we don't have any kids, so I was able to scream and cry and wail and have late night living room concert doing karaoke and dancing. And it would disturb no one but my dogs and my elderly neighbor, Rena. And also, I just had this incredible network of support right away. My best friend came in and moved in for the weekend and sat there with me and put up with me saying things like, can't order tacos right now because tacos is really a trigger word for me. Tight group of friends who ended up completely upending their Thanksgiving plans and rearranging to make a night so that I wouldn't have to miss the holiday. And then my family, who were looking forward to spending a Hawaiian Christmas together, instead having to just work through my mood swings and my eat, pray, love journey through the North Shore of Oahu and all of my very depressing Spotify playlists. And they didn't complain or let me know what they were missing. They just wrote it out with me and occasionally asked if we could switch to their Spotify accounts because my music was really depressing them. They gave me the gift of time and a space to heal. And I wanted to make the most of that time and that space in as quick of time as possible so that I could see what life was going to be like on the other side. And I also didn't know how much longer my best friend was going to hang around before she threw her hands up in frustration and yelled, "Car can't be a trigger word. That doesn't make any sense." And my dogs were getting really tired of my late night living room concerts. So I went to work and I cried and I journaled and I talked about this on stage, and I talked to my mom, and I talked to a therapist, and I talked to my friends, and I cried, and I made a PowerPoint presentation, and I faced my trigger words, and I cried, and I kept working through my process and my grief till one day I didn't cry, and then another, and then I had a day where I didn't reference the incident, and then a day where I didn't think about it. And I started to stop focusing on what I had lost and start to think about what I had. And sometimes I would cry not because I was sad, but because I was just completely overwhelmed by the love and support that was coming to me from my community. And just this sense of gratitude would overwhelm me. I was catching up with a friend recently and she was talking about how she was going through a bad breakup. And all I had for her at the time was, "It gets easier," which I know sounds so trite and simplistic. Gets easier? But it does, it gets easier. And no, it's not all sunshine and fucking rainbows. You know, doing that kind of work was brilliant and painful and earth-shattering and life-changing, but it was also exhausting. I'm still tender and sore from having my heart broken, and I mean, I still have moments that surprise me. But I will say that the positives outweigh the negatives. That's where I am right now. And considering the fact that we're in a global pandemic, I think that says a lot. This is what else I would say to my friend. Take time to heal. Lean into your pain as much as you can. Let people help you. You may feel completely alone and unloved and unlovable, but you are none of those things. Wade into the turbulent waters of your grief. And if you start to feel yourself go under, take the many hands that are being offered to you. Let them guide you back to shore. And this too shall pass.
I put you first and you adored it. Set fires to my forest. And you let it burn. Sing off key in my chorus.
Breaking up is a hard topic for me to discuss because it involves something different than what you might anticipate. For me, breaking up isn't about a long-lost love or the end of some kind of romantic fling. For me, it actually doesn't involve anyone else. It's just me. To start, I like to say that I wasn't as fortunate as some people to have the perfect coming out experience. There's so many people of the LGBTQ+ community who have sort of a normal coming out in so many respects. They announce at a younger age to their family, their friends, and their community that they are who they are. And while I was very fortunate to have friends and a community that knew, my family didn't find out until I was much older. In fact, I came out much later in life, at 27, and it was a very difficult experience for me. And that, for me, is the breaking up that I'd like to talk about. For so much of my life, formative years of my life, from being a teenager into college into early adulthood, I was never comfortable being who I really was around my family. I kind of had two different personalities, and it was exhausting. It was like being tormented, except the only culprit behind the tormentation was myself. I was tormenting myself by not being strong enough to come to my family and tell them who I was. And this alter life that I lived when I was with my family was like being with someone in the most toxic relationship imaginable, full of lies and deceit and anger and pain. And the only issue was is that other person didn't exist. That other person was myself. I was the bad relationship partner. I was the awful ex that you sit down and tell your friends about, and they all console you, and they're like, boy, you made the right decision to move on. That person didn't exist. That was me. And I think it hit me one day when there was like this just overflow of emotions. I remember I was sitting in my car after a family dinner and thinking to myself, if not now, then when? When will be the time that I will finally tell them that I'm gay? And when will I be able to finally become the person that I live on the side? When will that living on the side just be all the time? It's funny, when I was researching for this, I came across a quote, and I feel like it's so perfunctory to always say a quote when you're giving a talk like this, but it said, hard does not mean impossible. It occurred to me that I was not only living a lie, but this toxic relationship that I had created with myself had the potential to last forever. That I could very well spend the rest of my life not being who I really was. And just like every bad relationship or bad partner, it takes strength, it takes courage to say enough is enough. And so I did that. I told myself that this is not a life worth living. And if your life is going to be spent not being who you really are, well, what's the point of even living it? The most hysterical part about all this is when I finally did tell my family, it ended up being not only the most incredibly liberating experience, but also the easiest one, with many of my family members simply responding, oh yeah, we already knew. It made me realize that it is possible to find the strength in yourself to achieve anything, to love endlessly, and to always push yourself to a higher standard and to a higher enlightenment, to be the person that you were meant to be. And on that summer party, sometime in June or July, when I finally told them the truth, it felt like I had broken up with something more than just a relationship or a love. I felt like I had ended a part of my life that I was hoping to never go back to, and started one in which not only did I love myself completely, but I was able to express that love to everyone, including my family. I will say that since then, my family has welcomed my now husband into their arms, and they have joylessly accepted me and encouraged me to love and care about what matters most to me. And that's my story. And I just want to say to anyone out there who's ever afraid, and not necessarily about being gay, but about anything in life, yes, it's hard, but hard does not mean impossible. And you are capable of anything, especially if it involves your happiness and your love.
I saw my ex looking a mess and pressed up on somebody else. So I strutted up to the dance floor and I took off my earrings. I did a kick into a split and showed him what he was missing. Like, do I have your attention? Do I have your attention?